Hi friends, my name is Trish Roberts and you're watching Faint Signals from Vega. So I thought I'd do a quick live stream. It's been a couple of weeks since I've done a live stream and about veganism. And I wanted to tie in some of the recent mass shootings. I wanted to tie in that with veganism, if I may. And so I read, you know, on one of the live streams on Real Progressives, I read about in relation to the mass shooting, somebody said, I own guns. They are for hunting, not for hunting humans. That was what I was so upset about today. The assault weapons made me cry for the victims and their families. And I wanted to sort of talk about that. You know, when we say, oh, there's another person also wrote something, which was the more educated firearm users you have, the more honest everyone becomes. You don't kill the innocent. That isn't the gun. That's the person. So the thing about hunting is that these are innocent sentient beings in forests or wherever, and we're actually killing for entertainment. And some people might say, well, I'm actually killing for because I don't want to use factory farmed animals. I want to feed my family. Well, can you imagine if, say, 310 million people decided we're not going to buy factory farmed meat, we're going to go out into the forest and kill non-human animals? I mean, that would be really insane, to be honest. People would be dangerous for one, and also completely unsustainable. But and that's often the excuse some people give, you know, for hunting. But really, oftentimes hunting is really it's not like people actually need an excuse to really go out into the forest or into the wild, in quotes, to enjoy the forest and wildlife. You know, we don't need to have to kill for entertainment to go out and enjoy, you know, sort of wildlife in the forest. It's kind of sad. You know, it's a bit like that saying, you know, join the army and meet interesting people and then kill them, that sort of thing. It's like, you know, we can enjoy without killing. And unfortunately, I realize that there's a lot of people in the, you know, in the United States who hunting and guns is a part of the psyche, really, in the United States. And there's this definite, it's an unpopular issue. I mean, I'm pushing the envelope here for some because, like, you know, it's something that's often defended, this whole Second Amendment. And if I might just step aside for a second and talk about the Second Amendment, I was watching the Empire Files and Professor Gerald Horn, who is a black academic, and he's done a lot of research into the archives. And the Second Amendment, he says, he argues, was used to suppress any uprisings of slaves and black slaves, and also to suppress and kill, in quotes, marauding native indigenous people. That was, you know, he says, was the main driver of the Second Amendment. It was suppressing, you know, black slaves and killing off indigenous people and taking their land. So when people sort of talk about the Second Amendment, how important it is, we need to think about the white supremacist founding fathers and the white supremacist and oligarchic constitution, and that Second Amendment was a part of that. So, I mean, in fact, the American Revolution was a counter-revolution. It was a counter-insurgence against the British who were wanting to end slavery, and they wanted to end slavery. Excuse me, and the oligarchs in the founding fathers didn't want slavery to end. George Washington wanted, you know, was a real estate person. He had slaves, I think, too, and he wanted to take indigenous land. Thomas Jefferson owned slaves and all of that, and they were actually against the ending of slavery. So we must remember that. So the Second Amendment has something to do with that. And as far as when people say, well, hunting is about, you know, keeping down the populations of certain animals. And one of the reasons there is a rise in, say, for example, deer, is because we've killed off the predators, wolves, etc. And we've often done that because often we trap, poison, kill, and hunt predators that are in some ways might be threatening a threatening animal agriculture. And you see, here's where veganism comes in, because animal agriculture, I haven't got to the bit too about we're not needing animal products to survive, but animal agriculture is responsible for millions and millions and millions of different kinds of quote-unquote wildlife being trapped, poisoned, killed, and drowned everywhere to quote-unquote protect livestock. And that includes predators that are that in the natural balance of the in wildlife, in quotes, they keep the balance is, you know, the deer and the and wolves and etc. and mountain lions and all that. Mountain lions are also killed to quote unquote protect livestock, and you know it's sort of and just habitat clearing, etc. Because we are the ones that are in gross overpopulation. If anything, we need population control. Human beings, we've grossly overpopulated the planet and driving out all other species who belong here just like we do. So, you know, that's the thing that we need to remember, that, you know, those who say, oh, we need to go around hunting deer, etc., because we're in a, you know, they're overpopulating. Well, we're responsible for that imbalance because of our you know, killing off predators, etc., and creating enormous imbalance. So, you know, and the thing is, when people say, you know, I don't kill innocent beings, you know, I'm a hunter, I don't kill people, I'm responsible, you know, I hunt, I kill non-human animals. Well, they don't say non-human animals, they just say I hunt. Well, you know, the thing is that those animals are oftentimes, you know, I mean, I heard somebody talking about how they live next to a forest and they used to see this deer and her young children coming up to them often. And then one day they saw them being carted off on the front of a truck, and the two young were orphans. Now they're innocent. You know, in fact, all these animals are innocent. They're just going about their business in their habitat, and here we are coming in and just murdering them for entertainment and thinking that that's sort of something that is acceptable to do. It's sort of, you know, because we view other animals as things and as resources, and so, you know, when people say, you know, they're responsible hunters or whatever, that means nothing to me as a vegan, because, you know, the fact is we don't need animal products to survive. We can easily meet all of our nutrition requirements from plants and non-animal sources. So the only reason we can give for killing animals or getting other people to kill animals is that we think they taste good, or we like the idea of killing, because violence is addictive. Violence is addictive. And all those people who obtain guns, it's not just for target shooting. It's not just shooting cans or whatever. They often end up going out in groups and, you know, for entertainment and being in the wild. I mean, you often see people when they're fishing, really, if people really thought about it, the oftentimes when groups, and this is a sort of a bit of a hyper-masculine thing too, you know, when you get groups of men together and they go out fishing, it's really more about being out in the bonding as people in a nice environment. But they, instead of just being able to sit there and do that, they need some excuse to be all together. I'm not saying everybody's like this, but they need some excuse to all be together. And so they use the idea of killing animals killing sentient beings because fish are sentient, as a way of sort of bonding. Well, why? Why can't they just be there and enjoy the beauty of nature and without having to, you know, sort of torture sort of animals? And apart from the fact that, you know, there's there's no need for us to do that. It's not bonding at all. It's just a bonding over violence. The same thing goes with traditions of, you know, all these different traditions we have where we're killing sort of turkeys by the millions, you know, for traditions of Christmas or whatever. You know, why do we have to sit around at a table celebrating over the bodies, the tortured and killed bodies of sentient beings? Why do we have to do that? You know, if it's a celebration about nonviolence, you know, which Christmas is supposed to be about, you know, things like that, about, you know, sort of love and unity and connectedness and stuff, why do we have to celebrate over the tortured and dismembered bodies of sentient beings? So, you know, this is, there are people who get very upset about, they think that hunting is this tradition that should be upheld, and my father's father did this and whatever. There's a lot of traditions in the world that are problematic, that there are a lot of things that we've done during our time on this planet as humans that are problematic. Cannibalism, enslaving people, and thinking that, you know, enslaving people was seen as very, very normal. It was, you know, in, for example, in the United States, whole economies were built around the enslavement of black people. And as I said, you know, the whole constitution is a white supremacist oligarchic constitution. And so, you know, and white supremacy has traveled all through that, the history of the United States. And, you know, but slavery was seen as completely normal. Everybody, you know, grew up with, you know, slaves around them, slaves doing, helping capitalism grow. I mean, they were the black slaves were the basis of the United States bounding ahead. You know, capitalism just went ahead with cotton picking and everything else, you know, and that was seen as completely normal. But, you know, when of course there's neo-slavery today in prisons, with black, mostly black prisoners being used to, you know, to make items, Victoria's Secret and all sorts of things. You know, there's a neo-slavery in prison. So, you know, it's a whole different sort of slavery now, but slavery is not supposed to be legal. But the economy survived without, you know, sort of black slaves, literally legal black slaves. And people, you know, the economy survived and people, you know, went on. And the same goes, you know, for, you know, this taken for granted position that non-human animals are our resources and are our property. That is, legally, animals are viewed as property. Even the ones that we live with, like cats and dogs whom we live with, are still viewed as property by society, and we can just go off down to a vet and have them killed. You know, that's the value of animals today. You know, we're property owners. So, you know, this is the thing, you know, but that doesn't mean, when just because we have this indoctrination to believe that non-human animals are our resources and that we can breed them by the billions every year into existence to be used as our resources, and we do that in and we torture them along the way. I mean, anybody who believes that animal welfare has anything to do with non-human animals is mistaken. Animal welfare has everything to do with making industry economically efficient. And so we can cut off genitals of animals without anesthetic. We can cut off their sensitive beaks without anesthetic. We can cram them into large warehouses without any windows and call it free range, even though they're so frustrated and so anxious. They're absolutely almost insane. We've got all sorts of totally different set of rules for non-human animals and what we consider humane, in quotes, and what we would consider torture for humans. But, you know, so when people say, you know, guns are not for hunting humans, they're for hunting. Well, they're for hunting other sentient animals who don't happen to be human. And just because they're not human doesn't mean that we have the right to kill them. It really doesn't. Just like other people from other races, we don't have the right to enslave them simply because they're, from another race. It's sort of like an irrelevant criterion. Species is an irrelevant criterion as to whether non-human animals have the right to belong to the moral community. And I wanted to just talk about, I've talked about the psychology of, people enjoying being in the wild, in quotes, and using hunting as an excuse, to be in the wild. And there's a certain sort of hypermasculinity in that. And, it's a sort of a patriarchal position in a way, of having to have a reason to be together. Men being together in the wild is, we have to be killing something, which is very sad. And that fishing, is often people, if they're often just sitting there in some ways meditating, oftentimes they're not even that interested in what actually catching any fish. They're really just there with one another enjoying being together. And, but it's sad that we seem to think we need to, bond over killing. And as I said, violence is addictive. And I wanted to talk about, it's very sad what happened, with this recent event in Las Vegas. Very, very sad indeed. And it's always shocking. I was actually saying to someone just recently, I don't mean this in a joking way. I was actually saying it must be about time for another mass shooting in the United States, because literally it's a regular thing. And, there's literally enough guns in the United States for every single person, 300 million plus guns. They say that, 760 Americans were killed on average by their spouses, ex-spouses or dating partners between 2006 and 2014. And nearly 75% of those victims were the current partners or girlfriends of the shooter. And so, the whole property thing is tied up with this violence, the ability to kill easily with a firearm. That's the thing. It's like, when somebody is very depressed, it's very, very easy to just pick up a firearm and blow your brains out, basically. There's no time for any second thoughts about it. It's very, very easy. And the same thing goes when with domestic violence. There's throughout the world, there's rampant domestic violence. There's women being killed every single day in the world by their partners. And that's for another live stream about, our stereotypes of masculinity and what we're still promoting as a stereotype. And what is coming out in the mainstream media, and the sexism and misogyny, when you have guns in lots of people's home, it's very, very easy when there's a heated situation for the male partner to pick up a gun and it's oftentimes not only just their partner, but the whole family. I mean, you regularly see, male spouses killing not only their partner, the mother, but everybody, all the children in the family. And that's that. What behind that is the idea that I own these people. I own the children. I own the wife. And then they kill themselves. It's not just enough to kill themselves. They have to take the whole family with them. And so, these are the very problematic stereotypes, male stereotypes that we are continuing on in society. But you see, this idea of property, you know, we see non-human animals as property. And that's the only place where their property is in our mind. That's the only place where non-human animals are property, because in reality, they're just moral persons just like us, and that means they're not things. They're moral persons, meaning they are sentient, they care about life, they love their young, the young that we also make orphans when we go out hunting. And, you know, people say, well, I'm responsible, I don't kill pregnant deer or whatever. You're killing still. It doesn't matter if they're pregnant or not. They have their own groups of, they have their own nations, they have their own ideas of family. And when we go out and we go killing, we're actually killing their families, and they're innocent. You know, humans are innocent when mass shooters go and kill, just spray fire a crowd and kill people who are just out trying to have a nice time. And if there wasn't this incredible access to guns, they wouldn't really be able to do that, or it would be less likely. You know, whatever was going on with that particular person, Mr. Paddock, whatever was going on with him, if he didn't have access to semi-automatic weapons, who needs semi-automatic weapons? I mean, who, really? Who needs to be able to fire rounds and rounds and rounds and rounds without a break? Who needs it? Nobody needs to be able to do that. And that includes police being highly weaponized. I live in Australia, and we had an incident in the late 90s. It was 1996, I think, where somebody who actually had he was mentally disabled, and he had some real issues. You know, he had a few issues, and he ended up in Port Arthur in Tasmania, actually the state where I live. I wasn't living here at the time in Tasmania, but he actually killed dozens of people in the Port Arthur massacre. And after that incident, you know, he just went around. He went to this tourist spot, which is actually an old penal colony spot, and he just went into all these different cafes and he shot everybody with this, I think it was an automatic weapon. He just shot everybody he could come across, including children. He went out behind a tree where a couple of children were hiding, and he just shot them. You know, this is what happened in 1996. And that was very shocking, because we rarely have had, apart from putting aside that we've massacred, you know, Indigenous people in Tasmania, and in particular, we massacred pretty much every single Indigenous person here. So putting aside what's happened to Indigenous people, where we basically committed a genocide in Australia, and what has happened in the United States, that's, you know, when they say mass killings, it's the worst mass killing in the United States. No, it isn't. Indigenous people have been mass killed by the millions. But let's just talk about white people for a moment. So when it happened in 1996 in Tasmania, that was sort of the end of the proliferation of guns in Australia. The government took back any unregistered guns. They had an amnesty on it, and people handed in their weapons, and then they got rid of them. And there's never been a mass shooting since. And not only that, but people in Australia don't have this love of guns. There are people, of course, who do hunt. That's unfortunate. But, I mean, people don't do that as a recreational activity. You would never see anybody with guns on the wall, or that telling you they have guns. People just don't have them. It's not part of our culture. It's not part of our psyche. It's not something that we think is a great thing to do. And a lot of people, I have to say, you know, in the world, you know, in Australia in particular, just find the whole gun culture, love of guns, it's completely foreign. So, you know, that's where we're at in Australia. And police don't have to worry when they come up to cars. Police aren't heavily weaponized. They don't look anything like they do in the United States. They and they don't pull their guns before they come up to cars, and they don't expect people to have guns when they come up to cars, wherever. It's just not a thing here. It's not something police particularly worry about. Of course, there are criminal gangs. It's not a huge amount of gangs, but there are a certain amount of gangs, of course, who manage to get weapons. But that's sort of a rarity. Most Australians just don't have them. Police don't expect them to have them when they come to the door. They don't expect people to pull guns on them, and they don't expect to pull guns on people in cars either. And it really is a pleasure sort of to live in a country where you don't expect somebody, if you go out, to a gathering or a large gathering, you don't expect people to have an automatic weapon and just start firing and killing everybody. I mean, the amount of psychological trauma that those people, because there is a proliferation of automatic weapons, even just guns. I mean, why do people need guns? It doesn't save anybody. In fact, most people that are killed, even if they have guns, it doesn't help them. And a lot of people that are killed are children. Children killing children with guns. I mean, people, they have this high age of consent for sex in the United States, and yet children can carry around little rifles and kill, and they kill one another accidentally, or they kill their parents. It happens almost every other day. There are children accidentally killing themselves or killing their sister, or accidentally killing or injuring severely their parents. Why on earth do children need guns or have access to guns anyway? But and let's put aside this idea of responsible gun ownership. Why do we need these guns? Why do we need to be hunting and killing? Why is that seen as entertainment? Killing sentient animals. Sentient animals who love life just like we do. Why do we think that this is entertainment? Not only that, but violence is addictive. Violence is addictive. So when people have guns, they're not just getting guns to shoot targets. They're getting guns so they can go out and sit and wait with these high-powered scopes. How is that fair even? You've got, people call this a sport. When you've got these high-powered scopes and you can shoot animals from a mile away or whatever, And oftentimes they're not even killed on the spot. Those animals are injured and they go away and they suffer terribly, terribly before they die. This attitude of killing doesn't stop with non-human animals. It is an expression of an attitude which never ever stops with non-human animals. And now, people are fair game. People are fair game. When somebody gets upset, they can either take out their whole family, take out all their children and their whole family, or they can take out a whole bunch of people because they're upset with how the world is going. And they think, F everybody, I'm going to take out a whole bunch of people before I go. And in a society, particularly which is under great stress with neoliberalism, and people are seriously under stress, with terrible financial responsibilities and terrible crushing debt, with no hope, and they're born into socioeconomic circles where there's no hope of ever getting out of them. This is a recipe for disaster. It's a recipe for tremendous violence. And the system is violence. The system that we're born into is violent because it's not fair. It's socioeconomically unfair to most people, and it's getting more and more so, particularly to minority groups like Black people in the United States. It's set up that way. And now Black people are being funneled into prisons in a neo-slavery to supply cheap goods for the rest of us. I mean, this is where it's at. The system is violent. And what we're doing is an expression of violence. This whole, what we're doing to non-human animals is an expression of what we're doing to everybody in society. You know, when you have vulnerable groups, like non-human animals are vulnerable groups, when you and they can't do anything to stop us. When you have a vulnerable group and you do it because you can, you kill because you can, that attitude doesn't stay in a vacuum. It doesn't stay in a vacuum. And look what the US empire is doing to overseas. Look what they're doing, you know, in other countries, in Muslim majority countries, killing millions and millions of brown people overseas for resources and hegemony in the region because they can, because we've otherized a group so much. You know, this is what we do to non-human animals. We otherize a group to the point where we think they're things, that they're stupid, that they they're lesser, and that's what makes it easy for us to kill them and to exploit them. And this is what we're doing to brown people overseas. We've otherized them. With Islamophobia, we otherize Muslims to the point where all society has otherized them to the point where people just think they're violent and they want to spread, you know, violence and Sharia law and whatever the hell. There's all this complete myths happening in relation to Muslims, and you know, and that allows us to do whatever the hell we want to them in their own countries. In fact, we openly talk about taking their own resources in their country. Donald Trump hasn't read the handbook on imperialism and how you're not supposed to be that open about what U.S. imperialism, U.S. empire is doing. You're not supposed to be open about that and saying, literally open in the open, saying to the public, oh, well, you know, we're going to take their oil. You know, we're going to take the trillions of dollars of minerals in Afghanistan. You know, that's or funnel the opium profits, you know, to the CIA so they can continue on their coup d'etats, you know, decade after decade and overthrowing governments. I mean, you know, Donald Trump hasn't read the handbook on what U.S. imperialism, what we do, what the government does in other countries, and why they're able to do that is because they've basically indoctrinated the public to see brown people overseas as lesser, and therefore we can just go in and, it's a white man's burden thing. We can go in for quote-unquote humanitarian reasons and, and then take over their resources and for hegemony in the region. And that can only be done with otherization, and that's what we do to non-human animals. We otherize them to the point where we think we've basically assigned them to things and resources, and we can do whatever the hell we want with them. And we do. We breed them into existence by the hundreds of billions every year. In fact, they're so far removed from, they're genetically so manipulated that they can't even breed naturally anymore. We have to artificially inseminate them. We breed them into these situations. And I'm not just talking about industrialized factory farming in quotes. I'm talking about any sort of farming, whether the so-called humane farming, which is a nonsense. There's no such thing as humane farming. It's even if there were, it would still be unjust. You know, exploiting animals nicely does not exist. We still take their children from them and kill their children or enslave their children. We end up where, no matter if they're born in a mom and pop farm or on a large factory farm, you know, industrialized setting, in the end, they all wind up in these same awful horror houses of slaughterhouses. So, you know, that's the truth about the so-called humane farming. And I've done actually a video a few weeks ago called Humane, What's in a Word? And I invite you to watch that. So I'm just going to quickly look at some of my, I have a couple of other points that I wanted to make. I think I basically covered most of it. you know, the definition of violence and nonviolence, the definition, you know, nonviolence, just like justice, justice should not be exclusive. So, you know, when we say we believe in justice, that doesn't mean that we only include certain groups and then the others can go to hell. You know, it really doesn't. Justice is not exclusive. Justice not only includes humans, it includes non-human animals because they're sentient beings. They are fellow earthlings. They were here on the earth before we were. They were here. They are here on the earth. This is their home. They love life just like we do and do not want to die. They love life just like we do. They love their young. They interact with the world and one another. They have self-awareness and they love life just like we do. And just because they aren't like us, in quotes, doesn't mean we have the right to torture and kill them and exploit them and breed them into existence for our purposes. It really doesn't. We don't have the right to do that just because they're another species. Just like we don't have the right to do that if somebody's from another race or if they're a different sexual orientation or if they're a different, you know, if they're gender diverse or whatever, or, you know, if they're disabled or whatever. They don't have to be like us to deserve respect, to deserve not to be exploited, to deserve not to be killed. You know, so this is something that we need to broaden our idea of justice and we need to broaden our idea of nonviolence because nonviolence is also not not exclusive. Nonviolence includes not only human animals, but non-human animals. And when I talk about all this, and I'm sorry, when I talk about hunting, I'm not passing a judgment on people. I understand that people have been brought up in a country where hunting and where guns are revered, and that's been indoctrinated by the very powerful NRA and all of that. I understand where it comes from, but there comes a point when it is so, it's always that I think it's always been dysfunctional. But there comes a point where it is so dysfunctional having these guns, having the tremendous, how violence is just normalized. It's every show pretty much on TV has to have some form of violence. You know, it's just normalized. Going out with groups, violence is a part of the bonding thing. Sitting down to celebrations of Christmas, etc., or whatever other, you know, Thanksgiving is celebrated around the violence of a murdered animal. You know, where our whole society is geared around some sort of a addiction to or fetishization of violence. And so, you know, is it any wonder that you know, we're just, I mean, it's seriously, it's a serious addiction. Violence is an addiction, no matter what purposes you say you do it for. You know, people often, you know, they'll say, but I was violence, there was a good reason for it. You know, I was, you know, oftentimes, you know, the self-defense, of course, you know, if you're trapped and there's only one way of being able to defend yourself, well, hopefully you don't have to kill anybody. You can actually, you know, sort of in some way disable them enough that you can get away. But I mean, most of the reasons people are violent is either for entertainment or if they enjoy watching violence, it's for entertainment. You know, it's a major dysfunction in our society, and we need to really, really think about it. And that includes what we're doing to non-human animals when we are not vegan. Now, I'm talking about this now because each of us, if we're not vegan, we are responsible for somebody else having to be in the most horrific circumstances, like a slaughterhouse or whatever, and they have to be in these fast-paced moving slaughterhouse lines where animals are thrashing about, they're crying, they're distressed, and it's very dangerous work oftentimes, and horrific things. It's a horrific sort of a situation, and oftentimes these people are migrant workers. And we're actually, not only are we putting a non-human sentient animal through tremendous, horrific torture and extreme distress and eventually killing them, taking their life, but we're actually putting people, human beings, oftentimes in a disadvantaged state. We're putting them through such tremendous psychological distress, having to, one after the other, slash the throats with blood gushing everywhere, slashing throats of sentient animals who are hung upside down in shackles. And oftentimes they're not even stunned correctly, because the fast-paced moving production lines, they're so fast-paced that animals don't even get stunned to the point of unconsciousness, and they're still thrashing out, and they end up alive at hide ripping machines, or they're boiled alive. That's a very frequent thing with pigs in production lines. They're boiled alive. That's to do with removing their skin, but they're not stunned correctly. And that's millions of pigs every year. Millions of animals, in fact, are not stunned properly because of the fast pace, production lines, and they're boiled alive, or their skin is ripped off while they're alive. Their throats are slashed, and all sorts of, there's blood everywhere. It's a horror house. And so it's a horror for those sentient animals, and it is a horror for the people who are doing that. And when we are not vegan, and even if it's a mom and pop farm, if we get these animals that are killed, who are killed via a mom and pop farm, still have their children taken from them, they still oftentimes end up in the same slaughterhouse. And if they're not and if they're killed by those people on the farm, it's still wrong. It doesn't matter if they were stroking their heads and playing Mozart to them while they slit their throat. It's still taking, death is a harm. We're still taking their life from them. And and when their blood is draining from them, do you think that's fun? I mean, you know, have you ever been to had your blood given, your blood at a at one of those donation centers? Even just 500 mils can make you feel a little bit weak. Well, imagine most of your blood draining from you in front of you while people hold you down. You know, you literally, it's terrible, and sorry, it's disgusting. It's just, you know, we're better than that. We're better than that. And this is what we're participating in. We're getting others to do it. They're like hired assassins. We're getting other people to do this for us. Every time we sit down to drink a glass of milk or have a milk latte, we're actually responsible for little tiny calves being taken to slaughterhouses, male calves who are no use to the dairy industry, being taken to slaughterhouses, and they're still sucking on the thumbs of slaughterhouse workers as the slaughterhouse workers are taking them across to kill them. This is what we're participating in, young little calves that can barely walk, that have been on large trucks in blazing hot or freezing cold without their mother, crying, and the mother's crying back at the farm. You know, she's bellowing for days for her calf, and the calf is crying, has nothing to drink, and then ends up at this dreadful slaughterhouse, still sucking on the thumb of the slaughterhouse worker as the slaughterhouse worker is taking them to be killed. Can you imagine that? Imagine that's your job, to spend your day one after the other, every second, killing, 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 and blood and crying and animals distress. That's your job. That's what we're making people do when we're not vegan. Whether we're, and I'm not talking about just meat. I'm talking about dairy and eggs. Eggs are also, male chicks are completely useless to the egg industry, and they're thrown alive in macerators, alive and chopped up, while they're alive, and they're not even, some of them are still alive, and their limbs are hanging off them. And we're throwing millions of male chicks into these macerators, or throwing them into dustbins to suffocate and die. that's the egg industry. And also, you know, there's other things about the egg industry, and I'll post a link to that and you can check it out. It's full of torture, and so is the dairy industry. And I include organic dairy in that, and I'll post a link to that. Organic dairy is horrific too. There's violence in all of it, and there's killing in all of it, because, you know, eventually organic cows are not productive. What do they do with them? They kill them. And they also take male calves away and kill them. And they also enslave the female calves. And they have rape racks where they actually, you know, they literally rape cows to artificially inseminate them. So this is the sort of thing. That's an exploitation of motherhood. It's a feminist issue. You know, these are the things we need to think about. And this is not a judgmental thing. I'm not trying to make people feel bad. I'm just trying to present a reality. And when I talk about hunting is part of that. Hunting is part of a patriarchal view that anything, any non-human animal, or that any female animals can be used, that violence is okay, that violence is part of being masculine, or that violence is just part of life, that we should be able to do these things. It's about domination. It's about oppression. That's patriarchy. Do we really want to continue on with that? Because look where it's gotten us. You know, look where unfettered capitalism and patriarchy have gotten us. We are now on the edge of extinction, literally. And I actually personally, and you could probably say a lot of people feel that it's pretty much curtains for us as a species. It's like, basically runaway global warming at this point. But I mean, this is where unfettered capitalism and patriarchy has brought us, because we believe that this planet and every being on it is ours to do what we wish. And unfettered capitalism has decided that it is going to exploit till the very, very end. In fact, they even see, for example, the melting Arctic as a business opportunity. You know, this is where we are, the insanity of it. So, the whole idea of exploiting sentient animals or exploiting people, human animals, is a patriarchal domination, a patriarchal oppressive notion of domination. Do we really want to continue that way? It's also a speciesist notion, because if we, speciesism allows us to otherize sentient animals and see them as things. Racism allows us to otherize human groups and see them as lesser. And then we can go and take resources and kill them all and take resources in their country and have hegemony in that region. You know, heterosexism allows us to vilify people who are of different sexual orientations and vilify gender diverse people. You know, just because people are not like us, or just because they're not part of a majority, what appears to be a majority, doesn't mean we have the right to do that. And that's all I'm really saying, you know. And I started off with the hunting thing because it saddens me when I see people sort of saying how upset they are that humans are being mowed down by someone who happened to have some problem in their life, and they mow down hundreds of people with an automatic weapon. And yet they don't see that hunting, actually killing animals for entertainment, or killing them even though we don't need animal products to survive and we can easily meet all our nutritional requirements from plants and other animal sources, and yet we're doing it anyway. You know, underneath it all, if we were honest with ourselves, we enjoy killing. I mean, that's the truth. If we were really, really honest with ourselves, hunting means we enjoy killing. So that's really all I wanted to say. So I thank you very much for watching. I realize that this is a confronting issue for some people, particularly in the United States, because, you know, hunting is seen as such a tradition. But I really think it's important, you know, that we try and be open-minded about these issues and reassess It's important that we question everything, and that includes so-called traditions and, you know, these habits and conveniences. You know, it includes tradition. And that even, and I'm not even excluding Indigenous people from this. You know, when people say, oh, what about Indigenous people? You know, they say thank you to the animal after they kill them. It doesn't matter. It's still killing. It doesn't, you know, I mean, if somebody killed me and said thank you after it, is that going to make me feel good? Not really. Is that make it any better? Not really. You know, feeling grateful, particularly when we don't need to do it. You know, today we do not need animal products to survive at all. We never needed animal products to survive nutritionally anyhow, but we do not need them today. Definitely in these modern times with transport and everything else, we don't need it. And if you look at the movie Cowspiracy, the sustainability secret, animal agriculture is destroying the environment at 51% of greenhouse gases. We're clearing Amazon rainforest at 1 acre every second. Amazon rainforest, 1 acre every second for animal agriculture and for soy and other products to feed animals in animal agriculture. That's what we're doing. That's just a little snippet into what animal agriculture is doing to the planet. It is literally one of the greatest drivers of climate change and everything that means. That means the sixth mass extinction. That means 95,000 miles of dead zones in the ocean. That means destroying river systems. It means resources. It takes 1,100 gallons of water to make 1 gallon of milk. It takes huge amounts of water to make one hamburger, huge amounts. You know, the resources that go into this ridiculous and the arable land that is taken up with animal agriculture, animal agriculture takes up a third of the Earth's surface. It's ridiculous. It's completely backward. You know, putting aside that we don't have the right to kill sentient animals and use them this way, it is a completely ridiculous thing that we're doing. So I invite you to watch Cowspiracy, the sustainability secret, and look at the tremendous violence, the tremendous devastation that animal agriculture is doing to the planet. It's destroying the Amazon rainforest. It's the number one destructive force in the Amazon rainforest, and that is the lungs of the planet. Eventually, our love of animal products is actually overriding our... We love our animal products more than we love our own survival. I mean, that's the basic. Our taste pleasure trumps over our survival. How ridiculous is that? Aren't we more intelligent than that? So let's think about all these things. I mean, animal use is on so many levels problematic, morally and environmentally. It is a tremendous ignorance that has to stop. It's a tremendous violence that has to stop, and it is killing our environment as well. And there is no nice ways to exploit animals. There are no okay, nice, and better ways to exploit sentient beings. The whole idea of humane exploitation is an oxymoron. So anyway, that's all I wanted to say. So thank you very much for watching. I've kind of meandered all over the place, but sometimes that happens and sometimes I get a little lost. But I appreciate you taking the time to watch this, and I hope that you will consider that. And thanks so much again, and I look forward to your company again. My name's Trish Roberts, and you're watching Faint Signals from Vega. Till next time, bye for now.